Bisphenol A, also simply called BPA, is a chemical compound often used to make plastic bottles and line the inside of food cans. It is detectable in more than 90% of Americans, and even in low doses, it's linked to cancer, reproductive problems, behavioral problems, hormone disruption, and more. And there's a good chance that you have some in your fridge or your kitchen cabinet right now. Yay.
More than any other factor, it's this adaptability of the processes that has enabled plastics to achieve their conspicuous success within so short a time.
BPA was discovered by this bad boy here, Alexander Dienin, in 1891. He was studying phenols and discovered BPA as a phenol derivative. Although BPA wasn't manufactured in meaningful quantities until more than 60 years later, modern ways of producing BPA are not totally dissimilar to Dienin's method. It's made by a condensation reaction between phenol and propanone, using an acid catalyst, often hydrochloric acid. At the time of its invention/discovery, though, there was no call for manufactured plastics on an industrial scale, and little infrastructure to do so anyway. BPA wasn't even mentioned in a scientific paper until 1905 by Thomas Zinke of the University of Marburg, Germany. In 1932, Edward Charles Dodds discovered that BPA was a synthetic estrogen, although later study would find it was an incredibly weak one. It was never used as this, but instead a structurally similar compound called diethylstilbestro was produced, and that was used as a synthetic estrogen in both humans and animals, until the 1970s when it was banned for causing cancer, most likely. Polycarbonate, or PC resin, was invented in 1953, first by a chemist working for Bayer, and then, a week later, entirely independently, by a chemist working for General Electric. In PC, the main polycarbonate material is made by the reaction of BPA and phosgene. This was particularly desirable because, unlike most other plastics, PC can be molded and shaped without cracking or shattering. It's an electric insulator. It can be colored or be transparent, and it can be bended using certain techniques without the need to heat it, which means it can be very cheap to produce things out of polycarbonate. Production of polycarbonate began at Bayer in 1958 and at General Electric in 1960. And you might well call the 1960s the plastic revolution.
It's surprising no one's yet thought of applying the same principles to building houses. They say Rome wasn't built in a day. It could have been with the bubble blowing process.
Because PC was so versatile and durable, it could replace many applications of metal and wood and generally be cheaper, lighter, and often easier to maintain. Plastic finishes, furniture, telephones, carpets, gun stocks, water pipes, ashtrays, light fixtures, medical equipment, and toys. And, although transparent PC had an amber hue until it was refined out in 1971, it started to be used extensively for food packaging, including epoxy lining for metal cans, after being cleared by the FDA in 1963. In 1988, the EPA established a safe level of BPA contamination at 50 micrograms of BPA per kilogram of body weight per day. But contemporaneous studies already suggested that animals exposed to just 0.05 micrograms per kilo per day, or 1,000 times lower than the EPA safe level, had affected growth rates. In 1992, a medical doctor at Stanford, studying estrogen activity, David Feldman, made a surprising discovery. He and his team found estrogenic molecules in cultures of yeast without added hormones or precursors. After a series of experiments, the researchers discovered that estrogenic activity was present in yeast grown in plastic flasks, but not glass ones. The estrogenic molecules weren't coming from the yeast that they were testing, but rather from the polycarbonate, PC, flasks that the yeast was being grown in. Estrogen was literally leaching out of the plastic at room temperature. Feldman contacted Sabic Innovative Plastics, one of the big producers, and guess what? They'd already tested for this very thing, and found nothing. After this, however, came an explosion of academic study into the health effects of BPA, particularly concerning male reproduction. By the late 90s, the industry was firing back by funding studies that obviously had a vested interest in finding it was just everyone's imagination. Now, it's pretty clear that BPA is harmful. There are dry academic papers calling the evidence of harm overwhelming. But in 2001, the National Institute of Environmental Health Sciences and Environmental Protection Agency published a report that found there is credible evidence that low doses of BPA, Bisphenol A, can cause effects on specific endpoints, but they said things were inconclusive. In 2008, the National Toxicology Program Center for the Evaluation of Risks to Human Reproduction published a widely discussed paper that drew on lab studies on animals exposed to similar levels of BPA as humans. They concluded that BPA was a concern for effects on the brain, behavior, and prostate glands in fetuses, infants, and children. After this, various countries began banning the use of BPA in baby bottles, and a number of US retailers stopped selling such bottles voluntarily. That same year, the Natural Resources Defense Council, a non-profit organization, sued the FDA in an attempt to compel them to ban BPA, with Dr. Sarah Jensen saying, "As thousands of studies have already shown, BPA is a dangerous chemical that has no place in the food chain. Its use in food and beverage containers needs to be banned." That lawsuit was settled in 2011, with the FDA agreeing to finally make some sort of decision on BPA. But on the 30th of March 2012, they said they'd continue to allow BPA to remain in food packaging. But later that year, they did ban BPA in baby bottles and sippy cups, and then in 2013, they banned it in the lining of baby formula cans. But what we do know about BPA is the effects it has on people can be inherited by their children. As of 2023, BPA is banned in Europe in water bottles and in anything meant to contain food for a baby or a very small child. France has even banned BPA packaging, containers, and utensils intended to be used in direct contact with food by anyone, effective January 1st, 2015. In the US, a number of states have set their own rules, which take restrictions further than just the FDA ruling. But still, BPA in food containers is almost ubiquitous, and the exposure is minimal but constant. And I think that's a big part of why so little has been done. No one's going to autopsy a guy and say, "This man died of BPA." But we know that it contributes to a litany of health issues. If I were to list all of the long-term health effects, it would double the length of this video. It's linked to increased rates of heart disease, liver disease, endocrine disruption, obesity, and, just generally, death. A 2020 study found that the participants in the top third of almost 4,000 people in terms of traceable BPA in their urine were 49% more likely to die in the next 10 years than the lowest third. But who do you blame? The manufacturers? The people who make the containers for food? The people who put the food in the containers? BPA is far more innocuous than PFOA, which has a half-life of about 3.5 years in the human body. BPA only has a half-life of about 2 to 6 hours. But people get it in their bodies from drinking either bottled water or even water that has traveled through PC piping, from eating canned food, or eating food that is or has been in a plastic container. So it still turns up in 93% of Americans' bodies, and they're still exposed to it day after day. Coca-Cola still uses BPA. So does General Mills. So do Monster Energy drinks. Even though many companies have phased BPA out and are phasing it out right now, it's not always as simple as replacing containers. If you go to a fast food place, probably the cup won't contain BPA now, but what about the nozzle dispensing it? What about other things that the food has come into contact with on its long journey from factory to gullet? BPA's environmental damage doesn't come straight from the source of manufacture alone, although a good deal of it does come not from its production, but from after its use in industrial wastewater. But a big part of BPA's damage to the environment is plastic trash leaching into the ground and rivers. Plastic trash everywhere. Now, I could say something pithy, you know, and really witty about the FDA and why they haven't banned BPA in food containers across the US, something about the fire station being funded by pyromaniacs, but really, it's the entire world. And the reason that no one is taking on BPA is because it's not sexy, there's no political will, and there's no imminent danger. It's just another chemical that probably causes cancer, definitely isn't good for you if you get exposed to it all the time. Just one of many, many chemicals that do that. And also, polycarbonate was a $20 billion industry in the US alone in 2020, and it's worth about $25 billion now. And although only a fraction of that is food packaging, what are we gonna do? Go back to fresh food served in wicker baskets? Bring your own jar to the hip tank pump? People just don't care enough to do that. And honestly, I would not be surprised if in 20 years the advice is never drink or eat out of any plastic or use any plastic to cook with ever, because it seems regulation is always far, far behind industry use. And yes, plastic leeches. None of this is meant to make you freak out about plastics. If you have a plastic water bottle made from BPA in your sun-baked car and you drink from it at the end of the day, you'll get BPA in your blood probably. You probably already have it. And maybe if you do that every day for 10 years, maybe you'll get thyroid cancer. Maybe you'd get it anyway because no one's doing anything about this because there's loads of chemicals like this in everyday use that we're constantly exposed to. It's just the cost of doing business. I think we could all agree that getting cancer, might get cancer anyway, that's worth it if there's money to be made. Thanks very much for joining me. Goodbye.